Chapter 2. The Dead Man. "We found a murdered man up on the road," said the lad. His eyes were like two fever spots in his face, and his entire body trembled.
"I saw him too,"
stammered the old fisherman. "But I saw him first," said the lad. Beyond this, little more was said for some seconds. The shocking announcement struck us with a kind of paralysis. I could see how unbelievable this occurrence appeared to the people around me, how absurd it seemed, how perturbing. Precisely because it presented such an abrupt and violent contrast to our present comfortable state of warm summer calm. The wind wafted gently over the meadows, myriad birdsong filled the air, and from the sea below came the noisy, rapid pulse of a motorboat. A glass door was jerked open up in the summer hotel, and I heard the landlady complaining about the maids. Suddenly the bank clerk cried,
"But good heavens, we must go up there!"
We menfolk set off at once, half walking, half running and staring straight ahead. The ladies demurred briefly, then followed us at a slight distance. And the lad ran like an eager little puppy, sometimes ahead of us and sometimes getting under our feet. He led the way. We came through the forest, which took no more than 5 minutes, and there we met some people whom we swept along with us. We came out onto the desolate plain, which lay burning desert-like beneath the steaming sun. We stayed on the path that ran along the edge of the forest. As we ran, we spoke to the lad.
"Are you sure," we asked, "that you saw it right?"
"Yes, it's quite true," replied the lad. "I was meant to drive the cattle out onto the plain, but then I found him."
"How did you find him? Did you stumble over him?"
"No, but the big bull was standing sniffing at the grass with his muzzle. I yelled at him, but he wouldn't leave the spot, so I went over to see what the matter was. And then I saw the man down in a hollow. He was lying on his front with his face to the ground."
"And then what?"
"I was scared stiff and ran off as fast as I could. Down in the woods, I met a man carrying a tin pail. After I told him what I'd seen, we both ran back to the place. And then he said at once..."
"Yes, so then I said," interrupted the man himself, who was running alongside the lad. "So I said straight away that he'd been killed."
"How could you tell?"
"His head," muttered the man. "His head was hideous. But we're nearly there now."
And with that, we arrived. Down in a little hollow, so close to the edge of the forest that he was touched by its shadows, lay the man. The student, who was soon to take his medical examinations, was the first to reach him, and I heard him cry,
"It is Forestry Inspector Blinder."
And now we all recognized him, as did the ladies who arrived soon afterwards, somewhat short of breath. The dead man was the forestry inspector I had seen leaving Miss Hilda's apartment the night before. He was still dressed in the same green hunting jacket, and had his rifle with him. We could all see at once that he must have been killed, for there was a gaping wound in the back of his head. The poor fellow had been hurled headlong by the blow, and he must have died instantly, for his face was buried in the soft soil. He had fallen on top of the barrel of his rifle, so only the stock was protruding. The student asked for a pocket handkerchief. Having obtained one from one of the ladies, he laid it carefully over the wound. Then he got up and said,
"Nobody must move him."
One of the ladies sobbed. The scene had a peculiar atmosphere to it, reminiscent of a quiet burial at a simple country church on a fine spring day. The air was so marvelously bright and translucent, the chalk white kerchief over the murdered man's head stirred slightly, trembled at the edges. Out on the plain, the sun shone golden upon the cattle, and the beasts gazed at us with their great, stupid eyes. I am certain that nobody there at that moment was thinking about how the murder might have come to pass, nor did it occur to anybody to consider who the murderer might be. Everybody was too thoroughly absorbed in the matter at hand, in what had already happened. There was no room for other thoughts. Impressions had not yet become fixed, and the image of the event, of the fact at hand, was not yet fully formed. Only once the incredible had been confirmed as fact in people's minds, would the question arise. But how did this come about? The little medical student was clearly a born detective. He leapt up when he heard the little lad say,
"Here's the hat."
And when the lad bent down to pick it up, the student dashed over at once and seized him by the arm.
"Leave the hat where it is," he bellowed.
And the hat was left where it was. It was a green felt hat of the kind that hunters wear. It had a large button on the left-hand side and a smart band around the crown. It belonged to the dead forestry inspector. The medical student explained, with an expert air,
"A crime has taken place here," he said. "Our mutual friend, Forestry Inspector Blind, has been killed by a person unknown. As far as I can tell, his death must have been almost instantaneous,
and was caused by a blow to the back of the head with a blunt instrument.
This expression, a blunt instrument, with its veritable whiff of jail and police, made the ladies shudder. They gradually edged further and further away from the dreadful spot until, presently, only we menfolk were left standing around the body. The medical student was eager as ever.
"His hat is over there," he continued. "Naturally, it fell off when he was struck. It would be best to leave it untouched until the detective arrives."
"The detective?" I asked. "Are you expecting a detective?"
"Yes, of course," replied the medical student. "We must wire for a detective. I know of an excellent man in Christiania."
"But it will take him a great many hours to get here," I objected, "and we can't just leave the dead man lying here." This prospect gave the medical student pause for thought.
"We cannot let him lie out here overnight," he said. "If the detective cannot be here by midnight, then we must have the dead man carried indoors."
Since I travel a great deal, I always have about me a list of the railway and steamship routes. I took out my tables and sat down on the grass to study them. The medical student knelt down at my side and eagerly craned his neck over my tables. "It is 12 o'clock now," I said. "Are you quite certain the policeman you want to get hold of is in Christiania?"
"Pretty certain. I have his address."
"Very well. Then we shall send him a telegram. This telegram can hardly be in his possession before 2 o'clock, which means he cannot catch the fast train that leaves Christiania in half an hour. He must wait for the ordinary passenger train at 5:13.
"He is quite capable of ordering an extra train to be laid on."
"He will hardly do that. It is not a question of preventing a crime, after all, but of solving a mystery that has already come to light." "We must assume that he will wait until 5:13. He won't be able to get away especially quickly, either. The journey from Christiania to our nearest town takes 5 hours by rail, so he cannot possibly arrive in time to catch the afternoon boat out here.
He will most certainly find a fast motorboat."
"That may be so, but even a very fast motorboat cannot make the journey in under 4 hours. He cannot be here before 2 in the morning. The medical student shook his head.
"Ah, but you don't know the detective I am talking about," he said.
"Nonetheless," I replied, "we must consider the circumstances before us. Since it seems almost likely that the policeman cannot be here before 2 o'clock tomorrow morning, I believe we must arrange to have the dead man brought indoors."
"Yes, yes," replied the medical student. "There is certainly nothing else for it. But shall we take him down with us to the summer hotel?"
I was about to reply when I was interrupted by a man pushing his way through the crowd of people around us. It was the local police officer, the inspector. News of the sinister discovery had spread rapidly. Somebody had telephoned the inspector from the summer hotel, and he had cycled over in a matter of minutes. He was sorely confused by the whole unaccustomed business. I could see it in his pale face and trembling hands. He also recognized the man in the green hunting jacket straight away and muttered,
"Poor chap, what in the world is this about?" "He has been killed," answered the medical student. "You can see that for yourself."
The inspector bent over the body and whispered,
"Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed."
"We've agreed that the dead man must be taken inside," continued the medical student. "The detective can hardly be here before early tomorrow morning."
The medical student explained to him that a police expert from the capital was best placed to deal with this case, and the inspector agreed. He thanked the medical student courteously when he took it upon himself to summon the detective from Christiania to the scene of the murder. The inspector appeared all too happy to be relieved of a degree of responsibility. But where should the dead man be taken? Once again, there was talk of the summer hotel, and the inspector thought the dead man should, of course, be taken there to the place where he had been staying when still alive. I objected that this would be tantamount to driving away most of the guests, all of the ladies at least. Another place must be found. And then the inspector remembered that there was an uninhabited cabin some minutes' walk away, a little sand digger's hut. It was decided at once that the dead man should be taken there. There was plenty of assistance at hand. A makeshift stretcher was rigged up, the dead man was lifted onto it, and his rifle placed by his side. The dead man's face had not been injured at all. It was only slightly soiled with earth and sand. The medical student seized my arm.
"Why, look at him,"
he said.
"What is it?" "Look at his face. It's smiling."
"It seems quite expressionless to me," I replied. The medical student took a long look at the dead man.
"He was smiling," he muttered. "A disdainful smile crossed his face just before he was dealt the fatal blow."
The medical student suggested covering the dead man's face with his hunting hat. It was done. 4 of those present then bore the dead man to the sand digger's hut, whose dark grey walls were just visible against the brown heathland. The inspector walked beside them. I held back a little, for I've always had an insurmountable aversion to bodies and burials. But where was the medical student? I turned back. Believe it or not, there he was on all fours at the murder scene, sniffing around in the soil like a dog. I had to smile. He was a young chap, hardly more than 19 or 20 years old. He had probably been stuffed full of gripping yarns and fancy playing detective. He was searching for tracks, as if that were the way crimes were solved these days. Cupping my hand into a makeshift megaphone, I called out his name.
Hey, you!
My voice cut across the plain.
Are we going to go with them?
He got up slowly, brushing the dirt from his knees and sauntered towards me.
A strange business, he said. It cannot be long since he was killed.
So now the time for reflections had come. The observations had been gathered and nothing more was happening. We were beginning to think back, and the first question was, when did this happen? The next would inevitably be, how did it happen? I answered, let's ask the people at the hotel when he went out. I didn't see him at breakfast. We reached the ladies, who were standing in a huddle terrifying each other. We inquired, and nobody had seen the forestry inspector, but he had been in the habit of getting up early, much earlier than the other guests. Half an hour later, we were all gathered on the hotel veranda. The medical student had been driven to the telegraph office. We were all awaiting his return, keeping watch for him down the road. The inspector cycled by in a great hurry. The odd person went running past. Everybody now knew what had happened, and a sinister atmosphere had settled upon the farms. We saw people stop work in the fields. Some dashed into their houses with their tools on their backs. A gate clanged. It was the medical student running back from the telegraph office. He was swinging his cap so that its red silk lining gleamed in the sun and, while still a long way off, he called out to us.
I spoke to him on the telephone.
He was thoroughly worked up and terribly eager.
I have spoken to the man himself on the telephone,
he repeated as he stepped noisily up onto the veranda. He did not mention the policeman's name, but we all knew who he meant.
Is he coming?
We all cried at once.
Yes, he's coming as quickly as possible, but he couldn't say exactly when.
Let us not lose sight of the facts of the matter, I slipped in.
Who knows whether this was a murder?
What's that?
Perhaps it was an accident.
Impossible, unthinkable, said some. And we debated the matter at length. Suddenly one of the ladies asked,
but who in the world could have killed him?
Yes, who? That was the mystery. The forestry inspector certainly had no enemies that we knew of. He was a very peaceable chap, exceedingly reserved. He preferred not to mingle with the other guests, seldom spoke at mealtimes, and took long, solitary walks.
You knew him from before, didn't you? The medical student said to me. Perhaps you can think of something.
I only knew him in passing, I answered. I have met him perhaps two or three times altogether. I have no explanations to offer. Could it have been a case of murder with intent to rob? Most certainly not. The medical student and I had both noticed that Blinder was still in possession of both his diamond ring and his gold watch chain. Now the landlady arrived and informed us that the forestry inspector's bed had not been slept in. He had definitely not come home the night before. So it was possible that the murder could have happened the previous evening. The medical student was somewhat taken aback.
I might have been able to see that from the tracks, he muttered. It rained last night after all. When did it start raining?
Most thought the rain had started at around midnight. The medical student looked at me.
Something seems to have occurred to you, he said.
Yes, I answered. The rain started at almost exactly 1 o'clock.
How do you know?
I was up. I felt the first heavy drops fall. And I can tell you, ladies and gentlemen, that I walked across the plain between 11 o'clock and 1:30 the hour.
Did you hear anything?
I heard a carriage rattling along a road a long way off. That was all.
Had you come from the farm?
Yes, from Garnet Farm. Who was the last person to see him alive? I asked suddenly. The answers were various. Some had seen him last at the supper table. The landlady had seen him go up to his room an hour after that. One of the ladies had seen him in his hunting jacket with his rifle slung over his shoulder at 9:30. He had been on his way out then, had greeted them lady amicably, and said a few words to the effect that there would soon be rain. He had pointed up at the sky and said, "See those fluffy little clouds scuttling across the sky there, miss? The rain shower is driving them before him."
"But what about you?" asked the medical student. "Perhaps you saw him even later."
9:30, I answered. That was the last time I saw Forestry Inspector Blinder alive. I now told them what had happened to me on the previous evening, how I had seen Blinder leave Gyane Farm and vanish over the plain. I presented my whole account very carefully, saying nothing of the fact that the murdered man had come out of Miss Hilda's rooms. When I had finished, my listeners sat there for a long time, silent and deep in thought. The ladies looked diffidently at one another, and the medical student remarked, "It was a bit odd that you weren't allowed into the farm, wasn't it? Young Gyane is usually such a sociable man." "My impression," I replied, "is that something unusual was going on at the farm." The steward looked quite upset, and his tone of voice when he refused me entry to the house was oddly urgent. One way or another, I believe I was as unwelcome as could be at that precise moment, and I am sure that it had nothing to do with my person.
"Do you mean that something was going on at the farm?"
"Yes, I do."
"But you saw nothing unusual?"
"No, and I heard nothing either. But the lights that flickered from room to room suggested there was a certain amount of movement going on inside." The medical student murmured that perhaps the forestry inspector's death might be connected with the peculiar excitement that appeared to have been afoot at the usually peaceful farm.
"How did Blinder look yesterday evening? Was he agitated?"
"Not in the least," I replied. "He was as placid as ever. His face didn't betray the slightest agitation. He lit his pipe when he stopped about 10 paces away from where I was standing, right beside the big pear tree, and the match lit up his face so that I could see every feature. No, he was very calm." And so the talk buzzed on throughout the afternoon. The mysterious crime was still so perplexing that the same questions constantly came up time and time again. Imagination came into play. The small improbabilities began to swirl about. A terrible nervousness came over the ladies, who could barely eat. They picked away at the lightest dishes and left their glasses of milk half drunk, so intent were they on making each other jump with shuddersome talk of the murder. What was the forestry inspector doing there at Gyane Farm so late at night? It started with a mysterious glint in a pair of female eyes, a tight-lipped smile that betrayed some special knowledge, and before long the novel was in full flow. The forestry inspector and Miss Hilda had been seen together several times. Lord knows what business Blinder had down there in this part of the country if it wasn't to meet Miss Hilda, with all those great forests of his own to wander around in. Out of consideration, I had not mentioned Hilda's name. I was well aware of the lady's powers of deduction in a certain direction, and that is why I hadn't told them I'd seen Blinder leaving Hilda's private apartment at 10:30 at night. But still, the ladies scrabbled after any unlikely detail suggestive of a romantic drama. They half won over the medical student, and when, late in the afternoon, the rumor spread that Miss Hilda was driving past along the road, the veranda was stormed by hordes of ladies and gentlemen, who tumbled over one another in their sheer eagerness to catch a glimpse of their heroine. Miss Hilda was driving along in a four-wheeler. She was alone in the buggy and drove swiftly, reins gripped tightly and gaze fixed unswervingly ahead. On her head was a white flannel cap, secured in her thick brown hair with a long pin. I could see the pin clearly, see its gilt head gleaming, and I could see her profile clearly too. She was paler than usual, and there was a tightness about her features, as though she were on the point of tears. She dashed by in a terrible hurry, took a right turn, and the buggy vanished in a cloud of dust.
"To the inspector," somebody said. "She's off to see the inspector. He lives over that way."
Barely 5 minutes later, she drove back again in the opposite direction. But now the inspector was in the buggy with her. She had her whip at the ready, and her horse was streaming with sweat. The ladies were of the view that she wanted to see the dead man, because nobody was allowed into the sand digger's hut unless the inspector himself was present. And so she had fetched him. She had returned so quickly that she must have hauled the inspector out of his office as if it were a matter of life and death. And how she urged that horse. Long after the buggy had vanished into the depths of the forest, we could hear the scrape of its wheels against the road. As I heard the sound of the buggy being gradually muffled by the forest before finally dying away, a small event from the previous night came to my mind, my meeting with the fisherman. I remembered that he, too, had come from the plain, that he, like me, had stood listening to the distant sound of rolling carriage wheels. But what was it he had spoken of? The iron chariot. I saw him in my mind's eye, as he had stood there in the dark, small and scrawny, shaking his head at my question. "Who owns the iron chariot?" "Yes, indeed. Who does own it?" Over the course of the afternoon, Some of the locals came to the hotel. They wanted to hear more about the sinister events. They spoke in circumspections, voices low as those of funeral guests, pumping the serving staff and the landlady for information. Some were bold enough to approach the guests, striking up conversations with great, vague observations about the crops and the weather. All had been up to the sand digger's hut and the scene of the murder. The storekeeper told us that Miss Hilda had been into the hut and had seen the body, but had driven swiftly away again. She had not wept, but had been so terribly pale, deathly pale with taut features. It was curious that none of the locals ventured any definite statements about the cause of the crime or the possible identity of the murderer, although their idle chat and the expressions on their faces suggested that they had their own views on the matter. They spoke about the plane. There is something peculiar about that plane. Many things have happened out on that plane. And the old farm appeared to have its share of secrets too. Secrets people knew about, but preferred not to discuss. The evening descended, still and beautiful. We sat out on the veranda, and the conversation about the inevitable topic went back and forth, back and forth. The ladies becoming ever more tremulous as the daylight faded to grey. We still had that sense of incredulity, of impossibility, because the contrast was so stark. Out there on the plain brooded dark horror. Yet here we were, we few summer guests, sitting together in this mild and peaceful evening. We listened for the slap of oars from the sea and footsteps from the roads, surrounded by the delicate chirp of birdsong. As the cigar smoke rose straight into the air, a wonderful shade of pale blue. When the mosquitoes became too irksome, we moved into the lounge. Although the ladies were sleepy, they preferred not to retire for the night because they were too scared of being alone. Suddenly I heard somebody call my name. The cry came from out on the veranda, a voice I didn't recall having heard before. "Somebody is calling you," said the medical student. "Yes, I heard it myself." I got up swiftly, walked over, and opened both of the veranda doors. There was not a living soul to be seen out on the veranda, just empty basket chairs and a table. And on the table stood a couple of bottles of soda water and a few empty glasses. For a moment, I was quite nonplussed. But then I heard my name being called again, and now I saw a yellow straw hat beneath the veranda. When I walked forward a few paces, the straw hat vanished, and a head of grey hair came into view amid the foliage. The man standing there calling me was the fisherman from the previous night. I leant out over the balustrade and said, in an inexplicable effusion of benevolence, "Oh, it's you. What a pleasure to see you again. We spoke yesterday evening, did we not?"
"I've been at work all day," replied the man. "Otherwise, I'd have come ages ago. What may I do for you?"
The man squinted up at me with his clouded white eyes.
"Well, isn't it peculiar what happened?" he said.
"The murder, you mean?"
"Yes. It seems he was killed yesterday night."
"That seems to be the case."
"At around 11?
"It can't be said for certain. The last time he was seen alive was 10:30. I saw him myself."
"Well, isn't that strange? Isn't that strange?" muttered the man. "You heard it too, didn't you?" he added inquiringly.
"What?"
"The iron chariot. Both of us stood and listened to it, didn't we?"
The iron chariot rolling along, far off in the distance. A peculiar sensation began to quiver in my chest. "Had you come from the plane?" I asked the man.
"Yes," he replied. "I walked past the sand digger's hut at 10:30.
"Did you hear anything?"
"I heard nothing but the iron chariot."
"No cries?"
"No."
"Wait," I said. "I shall be back directly." I fetched my hat and my indispensable ivory-headed cane. I walked out onto the road and beckoned the man over. "Come with me," I said. "Tell me what you know about the iron chariot. Isn't it some old legend?"
"An old legend,"
muttered the man uncomprehendingly. He shook his head again.
"Let's sit ourselves down somewhere," he added. "It's so hard to talk while we're walking. Besides, you walk so fast and I'm tired. I've been at work all day."
He pointed to a rock that stood in the nearest patch of pastureland, like a shining skull in the lush grass. We walked over the meadow, damp with evening dew.
"It's getting late," I said as we sat down.
I was familiar with the slow ways of the local people and was keen for the man to hurry up.
"Yes," said the man. "At just this time yesterday, it had already happened."
Where did you first hear the Iron Chariot?
When I was already in the woods. I know the sound well. There's no mistaking it.
I've heard the Iron Chariot before, I can tell you.
When?
4 years ago.
The same night Omengyane passed away.
Was he murdered too?
No, he drowned.
His hat and cane were found,
washed ashore down on the big sandy beach. And a few days later, we found his rowing boat, capsized and banging against the rocks. But the body, it was never found.
How old was the man?
Over 50. Nobody could understand why on earth the old man had decided to row out to sea in a little open boat.
What a strange notion.
Yes, very strange.
We talked a bit about that, us folk here in the area. Just among ourselves, like.
We had our suspicions.
Suicide?
The man evades my question.
Everybody must answer for his own actions, he said.
But you heard the Iron Chariot that night, then?
Yes, I heard it just as clearly as last night.
It's an old farm, the Gyana place, and has a few strange secrets, I can tell you.
The man now launched into a long tale about the sinister portents that were often to be seen at the old farm. According to one legend, the man who had owned the farm 100 years ago or more had driven to his death in an iron chariot. He was a reserved, eccentric type who had traveled a great deal about the world, and about whom nobody had a good word to say. He had squandered his inheritance on countless half-crazed inventions. He had a particular obsession with horses and peculiar vehicles. In the end, he had a chariot manufactured that was made entirely of iron. With its two wheels and the large protective guard at the front, it was not unlike the war chariots of old used by the ancient Hebrews, the kind you might see in the illustrated Bible. It was in this chariot that he drove to his death one night, out upon the plain. Since then, whenever some strange, terrible thing was about to happen at Gyana Farm, or whenever somebody was about to die, people always heard the iron chariot rattling its way across the plain. But nobody had seen it, and it never left any tracks upon the road. Some claimed the iron chariot still lay hidden somewhere on the farm, concealed in some securely locked room in the huge barn building. The last time the chariot had been heard was 4 years ago, the night old Gyana had died. Many rumors had spread about this man. His financial affairs were said to be in some disorder, and it was plain to all that the farm had fallen into disrepair. But still, his vigorous, energetic son had managed to keep the whole thing above water, and even to pay off some of his father's debts. All this the fisherman told me in a halting, cautious manner, as if fearful of my distrust.
Now, we are the only ones who heard the Iron Chariot last night, he said at length, and I wanted to ask you if I should tell other people what I heard.
Why not?
The fisherman sat silent for a long time.
In the end, he muttered, they don't believe me. I've been to the parson and told him about all the strange things I've seen on land and sea both. I've been to the schoolmaster too. They just smiled at me and said I had a lively imagination. Now, though I think to myself, now maybe you'll get a fair hearing, with a man from the capital, a man of letters on your side.
Yes, indeed, because after all, you heard the Iron Chariot too, didn't you?
Once again, I was surprised by the fisherman's eagerness. I assured him that I would gladly stand by him.
I did indeed hear some carriage rolling across the plain last night, I said, but I cannot aver that it was a phantom chariot, of course.
Can't have been any other carriage, replied the fisherman decisively. Look at the roads. It rained last night, didn't it? And any carriage as heavy as the one we heard must have left tracks behind it. But you try looking. You'll soon see there aren't any wheel tracks on the roads. In this neck of the woods, the only people with horses are Gyane and the parson.
I had no wish to go into the matter further, so I told him he could tell his tale to a man who would be coming the next day.
What's your name? I asked.
Jan Jansen, he replied.
Very well, Jan Jansen. Early tomorrow, a policeman will arrive from Christiania on the mail boat. Speak to him. He will certainly listen to you with interest.
I lit a cigar to ward off the mosquitoes. The fisherman sat in silence for a long time, staring ahead despondently.
There's a wind blowing up, he said.
Wind? I exclaimed. But it is quite still here now. Look how the smoke from my cigar spreads out around us and lies in the air like blue veins.
Pointing over the forest and out to sea, the fisherman answered, "The southerly wind. When you hear that singing sound from the sea, far out there in the skerries, it means the wind's on its way." I listened. And then indeed it seemed to me that my ears were filled with a faint, incessant soughing, the kind of noise you do not hear unless you listen out for it. But that then becomes the only thing you can hear. Yet the night was still entirely windless. The light was merely drowsing, the colors had now faded, and the trees stood etched against the sky like skeletons of ash. Suddenly, the fisherman turned his head and leapt to his feet. He was listening, listening so intently that his mouth hung half open. "What do you hear?"
"I think I can hear."
He listened again for a long time, but then sat down again calmly upon the rock and muttered, "No, it was nothing." The fisherman was right. During the night, the wind picked up. When I went up to my room at around 1:30, the windows were rattling on their hinges, and the draft tore the door from my grasp, slamming it shut with a crash. I did not light my lamp, but stood by my window a while, staring out across the plain towards Guiana Farm. No lights were twinkling there now. The wind was blowing straight towards me. It rose up from the ocean, bearing a wet gust of salt sea inland with it. It seized hold of the trees and rocked their mighty canopies, filled the woods with a great soughing so that the whole forest seemed to be sweeping towards me, and its great breath rolled through the yellow wheat fields in vast swells. As I pulled my flapping jacket around me, I felt an icy chill in my armpits. The warm blanket of heat that had lain over us all day was torn to shreds at last and swept away by the wind. I seized the window to close it, but stopped suddenly when I caught a sound far off in the distance. A metallic rattling borne to me on the gusts of wind, and which rose and fell along with them. The sound was coming from the plain. It was the iron chariot again.